West Coast rap, grunge music, huge R&B hits, and good old-fashioned radio MTV-friendly pop songs. The 90s had an utter buffet of great music. All those genres stem from some of the most iconic albums released in the last 30 to 40 years. So we're going to take a look at some of those records on this all-new episode. And since we have no AKs, I feel like it's going to be a good day. Hello and welcome to Totally 80s and 90s Recall. This is a podcast where we'll take a look at everything the radical decades of the 1980s and 90s had to offer, from music and movies to television and pop culture. If you're new to the show, be excited that you found us because you're about to have an awesome time. And for all of our returning listeners and subscribers, it is great to have you back. I am one of your hosts, David, joined as always by someone who would have loved getting a gun rack from a pretty girl back in 1992. It is, of course, my most excellent friend, Rob.
Most excellent. Hey, today's episode goes out to all of you that wonder what a typical day is like for the two of us in the Recall studio. So all I can say is that our life is pretty plain. Dave and I like watching puddles gather rain. And all we can do is just pour some tea for two and speak our point of view. It's kind of what we do.
That is.
But it's not sane. It's not sane. Deep down, Dave and I really just want someone to say to us, "I'll always be there when you wake." And I don't understand why I sleep all day, and Dave starts to complain that there's no rain, and all we can do is read a book to stay awake, and it rips our life away, but it's a great escape. All Dave and I can say is that our life is pretty plain. Maybe you don't like our point of view, and you might think we're insane. If you walk away from today's episode learning nothing, we hope you hear this. You know we'd like to keep our cheeks dry today, so stay with us and we'll have it made. We will have it made.
That's good.
There you go.
We do have it made.
That's what we do. We like watching puddles. We like watching pour puddles. Tea we like for two.
All of it.
We read books to stay awake.
We do.
You complain about there being no rain.
There is. Oh, there's always rain.
There's not enough rain.
There's not enough rain. So, well, that's a good opening.
Yeah.
That's a great song. So it's a good start to today's podcast. Speaking of rain, we've had some crazy weather lately.
We have.
In fact, the weather did its best to basically keep you and I away from each other.
That's right. But it did not win.
It did not win. No. it did everything it could. We were supposed to record last week.
That's right.
And the weather said, no thanks. You don't get to record last week. We had a big ice storm, had some snow.
Yeah.
So school got canceled, all the good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so we persevered.
Persevered.
And it gave us more time to get ready for this episode because there was a lot in it. So,
there was a lot of prep.
A lot of prep. But again, the weather trying to keep us away from each other. I will go with the wise words of one of my favorite 80s groups, INXS, who said, "Yeah, push play, but nothing happened. So missed it. It's over." Not well executed. All it said was, "Never gonna tear us apart." That's okay. So.
That sucks.
We had a false start today, folks.
Oh my gosh.
We're not good at what we do. We try really hard, but
that's frustrating.
All right. Let's just dispatch with all the interludes.
Pleasantries.
I tried to do something funny. Didn't work. Failed miserably.
He's a big dumb animal,
but we can accept our failures on this show. So
I don't like to.
It's okay. It happens. So what we'll do is we'll move from the failure to the
sucks
topic of what we're covering on today's episode.
We are looking at top albums of 1992, but we're doing it like a draft style.
Yes. So
you get to draft. I get to draft.
Get to draft.
10 albums from 92.
Yes. Another draft. We did this previously, episode 26.
And you won the flip last time.
I did. I'm good with the flips.
Yeah.
Episode 26, we drafted our favorite number one hits from 1987. That was quite a drop down, drag out brawl to get the best songs between the two of us. Today, however, we're drafting, as you said, entire albums, not just songs. The only rules is that the album must have been released in 1992, and that you do have to draft them in some different categories, which I'll explain in a little bit. Friends of the show over at Pop Culture Yearbook, they draft at the end of all their episodes. But those three are pretty cordial and complimentary about their picks, even if they are just online friends. Uh-huh. But in this case, for the next hour or so, there are no friends on our draft day episode. If you steal some of the albums I've identified, Rob, I'm not going to be excited, and we will have beef. But I think drafting is fun. I think it's something different for us to do, and we're going to make it rock no matter what.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I'm excited. I think I put more prep into this one than I have in a long time.
In a long time. So. Well, there you go, folks. Just for everyone that tunes in every week, he doesn't put any prep to the other shows.
I put names in hats and I draw them out. I think that's what your wife told.
Well, the reason I chose 1992 for our albums that we're choosing from is because that was kind of I'd say 92 is where I kind of started collecting albums. Mm-hmm. Previous to that, I did a lot of like the cassette singles or mm-hmm. I just record something off the radio. But once I started driving and I had my
that's good.
I had my Pioneer removable face.
Detachable face.
CD player. Wow. I started actually getting albums. And a lot of the albums were in 92. So a lot of these albums we're going to talk about today are the first ones I had.
Okay.
And I used to get excited, you know, if I get people in the car, because mm-hmm. I'd time songs up from albums to be like, ooh.
Oh, yeah.
And I would actually be disappointed if they didn't mention, oh, that's a good song, yeah. or I have that album. But those plans sometimes would fail miserably when you got in the car because you just grabbed the book and you'd start taking things in and out. Be like, I want to listen to this one. I want to listen to that one. Or you'd say stuff like, we listened to that last time I was in here. So you'd swap it out. So
yeah, you got to change it up a little bit.
I guess. Yeah. It was my car.
Well,
every time you got in the car, you messed with the radio, whether it was on the radio or it was on it was the CDs. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You like to DJ.
I feel bad. I didn't.
They didn't hire you at that cakewalk for no reason. All right. So.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. You talked about a lot of the albums that are on my list are some of the first ones I owned.
Yeah.
But they were also some of the first ones that I'll talk about a quote in here. It might come up, but it's one of the people on this list, and they're talking about the making of an album and making an experience.
Oh, exactly.
And I really liked that quote. And I just thought it was a lot of these albums I picked because for me, they were an experience from first song to last song.
I agree.
Whether it was the cover art or the content or the liner notes. Right now, my kids are making fun of me. I got back into I didn't get back into it. My wife got me into vinyl. And the thing that I keep telling them that I like about it, I don't really care that it's vinyl. It's that you have to sit with it and you have to. You can read the liner notes and you got to listen to the whole thing. And sometimes there are themes and my kids don't get that. And so right now their thing is they listen to a minute and a half of a song and then they change it. It drives me nuts. And I'm like, listen to the whole album.
No. You know why your kids don't get that?
Right.
Cause you're saying old man things.
I know.
I want to sit and read the liner notes.
I do. I want to, I don't know. There's something about holding it and seeing it.
I used to do the same thing. I read them all. Yeah. I have this thing. I like to know the words.
Yeah.
So I'd read the words while I was singing the song so I could remember the words. So. Well,
and even on some of these, just the liner notes, there's pictures and there's art. And then that was part of it was the visual element of the audio.
So, these are great. This is going to be great. We got some really great albums here.
I just hope you don't take... I'm going to take
a lot. My whole job is to take from you today. So just like you took from me the beginning here.
What did I do?
Again, going back to our beginning where we kind of had that false start, you know, Kip is off today.
I know.
It's Kip's birthday.
He's stuck in the snow.
He's out of the studio. Yeah. He told me it was his birthday, so he lied.
He's lying.
Point is he's out of the studio, so Rob is running the board today.
That's never good.
And so we had a little NXS thing queued up.
I apologize. So, all the people out there, like, what kind of
they'll never know the song
half-assery is this podcast that I just tuned into?
There's another good hour to go, so we'll see if there's some more half-assery to go.
Right.
So
maybe we'll pull it out.
You know who will forgive you for all this?
Who?
The Robsters.
Oh,
they will be like, hey, you know, he's doing the best that he can.
That's right.
So
what's our slogan? We don't we don't follow the rules.
We don't follow the rules.
There's something like that.
Robsters. We don't follow the rules.
Yeah,
we are. Well, follow the rules. We are the rules.
Oh, crap.
All right. Well, let's blaze up the chronic, head outside to dig in the dirt, and hopefully not get ourselves totally crossed out as we check out our favorite albums from 1992. Sound. I never know what that sound is, but I love it.
It's intense.
It is intense. Well, we know that you love listening to Totally 80s and 90s Recall. I mean, we're dope. So if you never want to miss an episode, hit that subscribe button if you haven't done so already, and then share it with a friend you know loves the 80s or 90s. And if they don't, then Rob and I will convince them why they should. Also, because we love hearing from our listeners, if you happen to be on Apple or Spotify and think we're worthy, give us 5 stars. Toss us a review just to confirm how actually great we are. Mm-hmm. We love reading those. We have a good time, and it's a lot of fun. So as we said today, we are here to draft our favorite albums from 1992.
Yes.
All right. Again, only rule had to be released in 1992. And then we have 4 categories, rock, rap, pop, radio, and movie soundtrack. So of your first 4 picks, one of those you have to fall into one of those categories. And then your other 6 picks can be from any of those categories.
Really nervous.
So so the first 4, you kind of have to bounce around. You can't just load up on one genre right away. So, but we did flip a coin. And as Rob alluded to, I was again victorious because I'm good with coins. So I have the first pick.
I think I know what you're going to pick too.
And we're going to go back and forth.
All right. And I'm really mad. I'm
so angry, folks. So I am going to lead off with probably my favorite album of 1992. Probably one of my, I don't know, 5 favorite albums of the 90s, maybe of all time.
I know, if I really look
at it. And when I looked at the list of all the albums in 1992, Rob, I'm just torturing you for a second because I think I'm going to take what you want. As I looked at albums in all of 1992, this was easy. Like, this was easy first pick, and I was just hoping that I got it. It is Core by Stone Temple Pilots. Easy number one pick. I looked at all the albums. I had it at the top, just waiting.
I love it.
You love it.
I do.
Who doesn't love it?
Not my first pick, though.
Ah, you escaped. Oh, you're so happy now.
I am very happy.
All right. Well, this was the sample from the album I went with was Sex Type Thing.
Yep.
Maybe my favorite song on the album. It's top two, at least. So I really like that song a lot. As I said, best album for me in 1992. It was released September 29th. Mm-hmm. Is the band's best-selling album. The album peaked at number 3 on the Billboard 200 and has been certified 8 times platinum in the U.S. and was the 93rd best-selling album of the 1990s. 3 singles were released from the album, Sex Type Thing, which I just played, Plush, and Creep, with Plush being the most popular song. Critics and fans were split on STP at first, thinking they were trying to sound like other grunge bands like Pearl Jam and Alice in Chains. Mm-hmm. But upon a revisit by critics years later, Core has been heralded as a great album and Scott Whelan as a top-level frontman from that era.
Mm-hmm.
Rolling Stone ranked it number 11 of the 50 greatest grunge records of all time. And I'll say it's one of my favorite 5 favorite albums of all time.
And there's not
a bad song in the album. You can listen from front to back.
Mm-hmm.
And Dead and Bloated, which is the first song on the album, for me, might be one of the best opening songs to an album I've ever heard.
Agreed.
There's some really good ones out there. Dirt has a good one, some other ones. But it sets the tone immediately of the album. It gets you right in the mood, tells you exactly what it's going to be like, and it's awesome from start to finish.
I agree.
So
in the beginning, we were talking about one of the quotes, and this is from Rob DeLeo from the band. And he says, you know how when you listen to a Led Zeppelin album, you listen to the entire album, not just the odd song? We wanted to make a record like that. We wanted to create a vibe which would run right through the whole album. And I really like that quote because I think it encapsulates for me, this album.
Oh yeah.
Right. Because I remember listening to it and every song was a good song. There wasn't one that you skipped. There's a couple spoken word ones in there.
I even listened to that part.
And they're short, and you listen to them, and it feeds right to the next song. But yeah.
So. Oh, and by the way, per our rules, that falls into my rock category.
Okay. All right. Well, so, I had it as a backup.
So I have fulfilled my rock category of the first four picks.
Okay. But now you're forcing my hand.
Yes.
Because I have to decide if I want to go. Because if I do the one I want, then you could take the.
This is where. Now, but you're on the clock here, Rob.
Okay. All right. So, oh, yeah. We should have had a clock.
Yeah, we should have had a clock. Because you'll just wander around.
I will. Okay. Well, I'm changing up my strategy here.
Ooh.
So I'm going to go. I got to go find my new song. Sorry. I got to queue it up.
While you're queuing it up.
Okay. I'm ready.
We'll think to ourselves, what could Rob want to choose?
Okay. I'm ready.
He's ready.
Here's my first pick. Dang it. Okay.
First. All right.
It is. Final.
Locked in. Silence. Something about silence. Oh, really good. I was not expecting you to go number one with this. I thought I would have time to get it because I wanted this.
I know. But there's another one. Fantastic. I want really bad. Now I'm afraid you're going to take it.
These are the decisions you make.
Oh.
I will tell you that I wanted. What category are you falling this into?
I'm going to go rock.
Okay.
Yeah. Does that count? We're good?
It does.
Yeah.
I would just say from a strategy standpoint, I just chose a rock. So you had three more picks before I could choose a rock album.
I know. Anyway.
Fistful of Steel. Great.
I wanted it. I wanted it bad.
Yeah.
All right.
Really good.
This is Rage Against the Machine. It's their debut album. It came out in November of 92. Known for kind of having political theme, revolutionary lyrics. Here's just some of the accolades. Number 24 on Rolling Stone's list of 100 greatest metal albums of all time. Number 1 on the U.S. Billboard Heat Seekers. Number 45 on the U.S. Billboard 200. It went triple platinum. Multiple publications have ranked it as number 1. One of the best albums of the 90s. Is included in the book 1001 Albums You Must Hear Before You Die. Guitar World magazine ranked it number 5 on their list of top 10 list of guitar albums of 92. Here's what some people said about it. I really like these phrases. They call it a grenade that keeps on exploding. Among 90s albums, only Nevermind and The Chronic rival it for cultural impact. Era defining. No other debut album by a rock band in the 1990s was as crucial. The results burn with an undeniable conviction, a record of real attitude and energy, and one of the 50th heaviest albums of all time. A striking political conscious debut. I mean, it goes on. It's really good. Here's what Rolling Stone.
It is awesome.
It's really good.
It's not really
good. So in 2003, Rolling Stone put it on their 500 greatest albums of all time. It started at 368. Then in 2012, it went to 365. Then in 2020, it's 221. So it's moving up the list. It was number 24 on the magazine's list of 100 greatest metal albums of all time. And then a little interesting fact, the cover is we talked about the visual element of an album, right? So you got this cover of a Buddhist monk who was had set himself on fire. That was 1963. He was protesting
The leader in South Vietnam.
Persecution of the Buddhists in South Vietnam. So,
I think won like a Pulitzer Prize or something.
Yes.
That photo.
John F. Kennedy said of this photograph, no news picture in history has generated so much emotion around the world as that one. Nice. And he won the World Press Photo of the Year. Anyways.
Well,
that's my number one. I love it.
So Stone Temple Pilots and Rage right off the board immediately.
Okay.
Two pretty good number one draft picks. But you going with Rage opens my number two pick, which I didn't think I might get. But now my starting two is probably like Jordan and Pippen at this point. Because I'm going to go to the rap category.
Okay.
And I'm going to go with one Mr. Dr. Dre. Of course, it is The Chronic.
That's good. I'm okay, though.
So STP and Dr. Dre to lead it off. Two of the biggest albums of the year. It's like this and like that and like this and it's like that and like this and like that and it's like this and like that and like this and Dre creeped to the mic like a fan. Well, I'm peeping and I'm creeping and I'm creeping.
That's really good.
Yeah. That's the one right there, huh?
Yep. I like it.
So that was, if you don't know, that's nothing but a G thing.
Yes.
Everyone probably knows that at this point. First big rap album of my teenage years. I was very excited when I bought it. I couldn't believe. Had to go to the store. I thought I was a straight G when I got this CD. The debut studio album featured Snoop Doggy Dogg and some others. Was released December 15th, 1992. So just made it in there. Hit number 3 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 200. Number 1 on the top R&B hip-hop charts. And was the number 6th sold album for all of 1993 on the U.S. Billboard 200. It is certified 3 times platinum in the U.S. And in 2019, it was selected for the Library of Congress for preservation in the National Recording Registry for cultural significance. It was highly regarded by everyone except the Village Voice, which gave it a C+. I did not like their grade. And Rolling Stone included The Chronic on its list of the 500 greatest albums of all time. Culturally, it introduced gangsta rap, as it was called, to the mainstream. Every suburban kid now knows that Compton's a city in L.A. You could wear a black White Sox hat and some sort of black starter jacket, because before then, those weren't things we all wore in the mean streets of Milwaukee.
No, we did not.
It introduced me to terms like 187, which is a police code for homicide, a 6'4 lowrider vehicle, which I didn't really know what that was. And for some of us, terms like The Chronic, because until I heard this, The Chronic, I didn't know that was another word for marijuana. So, because I was a sheltered child. Tons of accolades. It's on every must-listen list. Mm-hmm. It won a Grammy. It's amazing. One of the best albums of all time in my lifetime to this point. I can't say enough about it. Significantly cultural is exactly correct, because I remember the first time I heard this, it was like a whole new thing.
Yeah. So, so I'm going to backtrack a little bit. I found, I was going to use it later, but I'm going to use it now. So blogger Chris Glidden, he references the Guardian categories. So the Guardian's a magazine, online magazine. They had categories for determine if an album was good. And so they used, the Guardian said history, theme, cover art, and flow. Like, does it all flow together?
Yeah.
Then this blogger added replayability, production technique, arrangement, so the variety or lack of variety of sound, and energy. And I think if you ran this album, the one you're talking about, through history, theme, cover art, flow,
all of it,
replayability, production technique, arrangement, and energy, it hits them all.
Hits them all.
Because even when you listen to the thing I remember about this album that I liked when I first got it, that I thought was different than anything I'd ever heard, is it told a story, right?
It did.
So you hear the songs, and then in between there's the little interludes.
There is.
And there's spoken, you know, and
some
there's
radio
some,
stuff.
Yeah, things, you know, and so it's this experience kind of, and it's telling a story as you go along. And I just think that's really cool.
Yep.
That was really well done.
So I've done rock and I've done rap for my first two picks.
Okay. And I'm also going to go rap for my second pick.
All right. I was hoping I could get this on the backslide, but I know what you're going to pick. Well, I think I know.
All right. And I'm going to start this from the beginning, because I changed up my.
Yeah, exactly. So I was between The Chronic and this, but I listened. Yeah.
This is going to be my number one, actually. But I was worried.
I'm a little upset you took it. I love this song. The song is timeless.
Well, and I picked this song.
It's the best song.
But it wasn't the original song I picked that I wanted to share. Because I...
It's great.
Yeah. Ugh. The song that I
flow like
the
a
mudslide. Song that I wanted to play
was
I'm gonna do it anyway.
All right.
Because we can.
Yeah. No, we have no rules. Cares, we have no rules on this show.
It's called Groove Holmes.
Yep. Look, I know the whole album start to finish.
And the reason I juxtapose the two styles.
Yes.
You know. But as I was getting ready
there
for this.
There are a ton of styles on this whole album.
That's why I picked it. That's why I wanted to pick it number one. Because I, quite honestly, I think if I could, this should be my number one. Because it was going to be my number one.
Yes.
But getting ready for this, I had listened to this. I hadn't listened to it in a long time. And I listened to it on repeat on my way to work, at work. And I think it's probably the best album of 92. That's my,
ooh.
That's my.
Better than Core?
I do. I think it's better.
All right. So this is
Check Your Head by the Beastie Boys. It's the third studio album by the Beastie Boys. I found this interesting. They named the album after a checkmark that Money Mark, he was a producer, randomly put on the head of a Desert Storm trading card of General Norman Schwarzkopf. So he put the check on it, and then somebody said, oh, check your head. Yep. And then that's where it just stuck. It stuck. April 21st, 1992, there was a three-year time span between Paul's Boutique and Check Your Head. I didn't know this, but Paul's Boutique was considered a failure.
It was.
I did not know that.
Yeah, because
I listened to it again. I have it, and I listened to it, and I was like, great. So good.
Well, now people go back and say, oh, that's their best album. Yeah. Like, if it's meta now to go, that's the best album. But when it came out, it was so different than License to Ill that everybody was like, they're like, what is this supposed to be? Where are the Fight for Your Right to Party songs? Where are all those?
Right.
And so everybody was like, well, this sucks. It's all instrumental and like remixed. And then you come back to it and you're like, okay, we were dumb.
So the president, and most people consider the Beastie Boys washed up by the turn of the decade. Check this out. The president of Capitol Records allegedly told them that he couldn't focus on their next album because he had the new Donny Osmond to worry about.
I mean, he's a soldier of love. What are you going to do?
Holy cow.
He's out there fighting love for everybody.
So dumb. It's a return to their punk roots. They played their own instruments on the majority of the album. So that was the inspiration for the cover, was because they're all sitting there with their instruments. Widespread acclaim. People said it's the cross-pollination of styles and Entertainment Weekly. A couple people didn't like it. Entertainment Weekly. Entertainment Weekly's David Brown said, on the other hand, he panned the album as a muddled, clanking mess, which is
aggressive.
Offensive.
Yes.
The Village Voice called Check Your Head a great concept. The execution is halfway there at best.
I don't know who's writing things at the Village Voice, because they also gave Core like a bad grade too. So bad. Village Voice, 92 fired.
Yeah, no.
That's right.
A quarter century later, Check Your Head still slaps brilliant, eternally progressive, and proof of rap rock's rarely realized potential. It's what we wanted then and still could use now. I love that phrase.
Yep.
Spin put it number 4 on their list of the 20 best albums of the year, number 12 on their list of the 90 greatest albums of the 90s. The Village Voice gave it number 5 on their year-end poll.
Oh, well, now they come around. There you go.
Alternative Press, number 23 on their list of the top 99 albums released from 85 to 95. Pitchfork gave it 67 on their top 150 albums of the 90s. Rolling Stone, 500 greatest albums of all time. In 2003, not ranked.
Nice.
2012, not ranked. 2020, number 261. So the last thing I put, I said, it felt like a record they wanted to make.
It was.
When I listened to it, it sounds like three guys got in the studio and said, what kind of music do we want to make? Yep. This is our, they put it on their label.
On this one, they also did less of remixes and more instruments that they played.
Yeah.
Their own instruments.
And again, like we were talking about, it goes kind of a song, instrumental, song, instrumental. The whole thing, and then it's different styles. I just think it's
first time I ever heard
production
that.
Value.
First time so I ever good. Heard What You Want. My friend Ike picked me up. We were going to Hit, and we were in his car, and this was what he was playing. And I was like, "What is this?" He goes, "New Beastie Boys album." And I was like, "What?" He goes, "Check your head." He goes, "It's right there." So he had the CD case in his glove box. I looked at it like that night. I was at the mall buying it, just listening to it on the way to Hit. I was like, "This is fantastic. I love it."
Yep.
So that's a must. That was going to be, here's the deal. It was an exchange. Had I drafted that, you would have took the Chronic, right? Mm-hmm. If I had drafted, Rage Against the Machine first, you would have took Core.
See, that's
so how, there was no way I was going to get both or all four of those.
See, that's why you forced my hand, because I was afraid if I went Check Your Head number 2, you'd take Rage, and I wanted it. So
Well, I would have also took Rage though in the Rock category, and I already took my Rock pick. So unfortunate. So, my third pick in this draft,
okay.
I'm going to go to the pop radio category, and I'm going to go with a little band called The Gin Blossoms.
Oh.
New Miserable Experience is the name of the album.
Love it. Good pick.
Now, there could be some controversy should this fall in the rock category. I think it's more radio pop rock to me. That's why I have it in my radio pop category.
I think it counts. It was on the radio it was everywhere.
I think it's more radio than it was, Stone Temple Pilots and Rage Against the Machine. This is one of the catchiest songs of the 90s.
Yeah.
So good.
Well, in a previous episode, we talked about somebody in the band saying, you hear it everywhere. You hear it at Home Depot. And then you sing it. You know it.
If you don't know it, it's Hey Jealousy. That's the sample I gave, but there's a lot of other great songs on the album. It's been said many times in the year that we've had this podcast, but I love the Gin Blossoms. I love this album. I think Rob agrees most of the time. All the songs sound fun and make you feel good to sing along to, even if the true meaning of the songs might be a little different. If you actually go look at them, some of them are a little depressing, but the way that they spin it, you're like, oh, this is a fun song. So maybe it's not about drugs or killing myself. It just sounds like the early 90s, feels like that time in my life. And several of these songs have been used in 90s movies, TV shows. So it just resonates for me with that era and that time. It was released in August of 1992, great month, our birthday month. It released six singles with four highly popular radio hits. Hey, Jealousy, as I just played, Until I Fall Away, Found Out About You, and Allison Road. It only went to number 30 on the US Billboard 200, but has been certified four times platinum. Initially, the album received little fanfare and not so great reviews, but after Hey Jealousy jumped into the top 40 radio almost a year later in 1993, the CD was re-released with a new album cover, and then it took off for a second time. So definitely had staying power, as in 1994, over 2 years after its initial release, the album was the 54th best ranked record of the year on the year-end Billboard Hot 200. I actually heard, now it got more popular in 93, but I actually heard Hey Jealousy before it hit the radio. I was in a friend's car, I heard it. I forget her name, but it was a girl. She was giving me a ride home, and I heard this song. She was listening to it. I was like, what is this? It's the Gin Blossoms. I was like, oh, I hadn't really heard this before. And then, you know, 6-7 months later, it's blowing on up MTV. It's doing all this. And I was like, I know that song. I love that song. Yeah. And I will admit, I probably didn't buy the CD in 92.
No.
But then in 93, when I heard it again, I'm like, I really like that song. Mm-hmm. And so I bought the CD.
Yep. So yeah, I got it later. This is a Columbia House purchase.
Columbia House theft. Did you purchase it, or did you just get your 10 for free or 1 cent?
Oh, I got my 10 for free.
Okay. Well, that was 1 cent.
But then they always got me for more. Free. They got money out of me.
You were good. You paid your fees. I just took CDs. No.
Columbia House took me for...
They took you for a ride.
They were like, sucker.
So this could not have been a better start for me. I got
that's good.
Stone Temple Pilots. I got Dr. Dre, and I got Hey Jealousy on my first three picks.
I'm very happy with my picks as well. And I will tell you, after this next pick... my choices are going to confuzzle you.
Here we go.
And
are you going to pick the idea is you're supposed to pick albums that probably resonated in 92 when you were that age, and not albums as your 40 something year old listening to now and go, oh, that's really good. I didn't know, you know. John Williams in the you know, Pandora's box. You know, they have a great three album trio, blah blah blah.
No, I can do it. Well, there's one on here that will fall into that category.
No, of course.
The rest will.
And I'm going to challenge to say, did you really listen to this when you were 14 years old? And we'll see what your answer is.
Well, maybe two of them I'll say no.
Okay. Mm. Yeah, it's your turn.
It's my turn.
Yeah.
All right. My turn.
People love when you're drinking on air when you're supposed to be delivering dialogue.
It's soda. I'm not.
We're having a heck of a day. We got a false start.
Don't care.
Yeah, we got that.
I don't care.
Everyone's
don't care
aware.
Anymore. I don't care anymore. I'm going to go movie category.
Oh, movie. Nice.
Yeah, I'm going to jump. I kind of waited.
Do whatever you want. Yeah,
I can do whatever I want. This is the single soundtrack.
I know what this is.
All right.
And it's really good. Yeah. I was going to sample Crown of Thorns.
Oh, you're going to,
not Wood.
No.
I love Wood.
Chloe Dancer,
Crown of Thorns. I was going to go Chloe Dancer. Because I really like that.
Yeah.
So you went with the obvious movie soundtrack pick of 1992.
Well, it was that. The Bodyguard.
Oh,
that was my backup.
Those are the only two you scouted?
Those are the only two I wanted. I was hoping. So if you picked one, I was going to take the other. I didn't care. So this is the single soundtrack, 1992, obviously released in June of 92.
June.
Almost 3 months before the film.
Nice.
Yeah. Some accolades. It's certified two times platinum. In 2019, it was ranked number 19 on Rolling Stone's 50 Greatest Grunge Albums list, which I thought was pretty cool.
Really good.
Just some of the tracks on here. Wood, Alice in Chains. Breath, Pearl Jam. Seasons, Chris Cornell. You got Paul Westerberg on there, Dyslexic Heart. You got Battle of the Evermore. The Love Mongers, it's a cover of Led Zeppelin. Mentioned Chloe Dancer, Crown of Thorns, Mother Love Bone, Birth Ritual by Soundgarden, another Pearl Jam song, Mud Honey, Jimi Hendrix, Screaming Trees, and the Smashing Pumpkins, all on one album, which is just, it's a killer. One day after the death of Chris Cornell in 2017, sad day, a deluxe edition of the album featuring a bonus disc with 18 additional tracks to commemorate the original album's 25th anniversary was released. The release day was only a coincidence, as the album's release date had been announced in January. So the fact that they released it the day after Chris Cornell, total coincidence. Anyway, yep. Here's a quote that I really liked. The soundtrack is considered to have helped open the door to the explosive popularity of Seattle grunge in the early 1990s. According to Steve Hewitt of AllMusic, singles helped crystallize the idea of the Seattle scene in the mainstream public's mind. And it was also one of the first big-selling 90s movie soundtrack. It went platinum and reached the top 10. To feature largely new work from contemporary artists. We have to remember these were new songs at the time. Like that's right. These have all become regular hits now. It's a milestone in the breakthrough of alternative rock into mainstream popular culture, neatly and effectively packaging the Seattle phenomenon for the wider national consciousness. I just thought that was
that's good.
Well said of that album. Trivia also included in the bonus is a song called "Touch Me, I'm Dick" by Matt Dillon, a fictional band in the film. He was part of a fictional band in a film. That was recorded by Pearl Jam's Eddie Vedder, Stone Gossard, and Jeff Ament. Do you know the name of the band in the movie?
Oh, I've only seen singles like once.
Yeah, that's the other thing is it's Citizen Dick.
Ah, yes. Yeah. I think you said that, and then I didn't repeat it.
That's the other thing I put down is that I've watched the movie.
Yeah,
the movie it's okay.
The movie is blah.
It's a typical '90s kind of rom-com set in Seattle.
The album is superior to the movie.
There you go. So that's my number.
Couple things I saw. A couple songs used in the movie, not on the soundtrack. A couple songs by the Pixies, R.E.M, Jane's Addiction.
Oh, yeah.
So you had those three big hitters, but they didn't get onto the soundtrack.
No.
Also, Cameron Crowe moved to Seattle in 1986, and he actually hung out with Chris Cornell a lot. Like, they were really good friends.
Yeah.
And that's where he did the research. So some of what Matt Dillon is supposed to be is based on, like, how Chris Cornell was living when Cameron Crowe met him. So put that math together how you want to. But so I don't think Matt Dillon is Chris Cornell, but that's fine.
No.
As long as he's happy with it. Well, obviously for my number four pick, I'm also doing a movie soundtrack because I waited to the end for that. So singles was not my first choice. My first choice goes in a completely opposite direction. Also not the Bodyguard soundtrack. It is the Boomerang soundtrack.
Oh, I thought about it.
Ah, yes. And then my sample is from Boys to Men with, of course, End of the Road.
Oh, it's a good one.
I love this album.
And you like this movie.
Yeah, the movie's fantastic. I like this part of the song because Wanye really gets emotional.
Here it goes.
Yeah.
Oh, he almost
So they said, I watched that documentary on Netflix about Boys to Men, and he cracked in the studio when he did that part because he couldn't quite get to that.
And they left it.
And Babyface was like, no, that's perfect. They love it. And then, people have come out later and they're like, that's their favorite part is where he kind of cracks because it's so emotional. He's so overcome by how much, this is the end of the road that they just think it's the best thing ever. Yeah. So. All right, so this is the Boomerang soundtrack. As I said, various artists, obviously. End of the Road alone is enough to make this soundtrack great. But then you throw in some PM Dawn and I Die Without You. Johnny Gill, Tony Braxton, Babyface, A Tribe Called Quest. Yeah. And this is just an awesome soundtrack. Yeah. There's so much going on here. Released June 30th, 1992 to accompany the movie, which is, as Rob said, awesome. Stars Eddie Murphy. Very funny. Everyone should go watch it. If you haven't seen it in a long time, you will not be disappointed. It peaked at number 4 on the Billboard 200 sales chart, number 1 on the top R&B hip-hop chart. Number 1, that's pretty good. As well as being certified platinum 3 times. I saw the movie, liked the music, absolutely love End of the Road. So getting this album was a no-brainer. Had it for a long time. I don't have it anymore.
Yeah.
Maybe I should get it back. I can just get it off, Spotify or something like that. So, and if you haven't seen Boomerang, it's awesome too. My favorite part is when she goes, Marcus. He sleeps with the old lady thinking she's in charge of the company. And she's
crazy hot. Lady.
Lady Eloise. She sets Eartha Kitt and she like me. She goes, All right. Crazy. So Boomerang soundtrack. So
those are good.
Right. I got my top four picks in all of the first four categories.
Okay.
And now, after you make your fourth pick in the pop rock or pop radio category.
It is my pop radio.
The next six picks is where I go ruthless on you. So
okay. That's fine. And that's okay. And I think I'm okay.
You are, because you're going to pick weird albums at this point. So.
Well, it's my draft.
I know it's your draft.
So anyway, all right. My number four is pop. Like you said, pop radio. So this is not the song that you would have heard. Real Love would have been the song you heard on the radio. But for me, this song on the album.
How did I know you'd pick Mary J. Blige? anyone who's listened to our show knew you were going to pick Mary J. Blige.
Gosh, I love this album. I have to admit something. I repurchased this CD.
Oh.
I had it. I couldn't find it. I know I had it at one time. And it's back in the collection.
Back.
Anyway, so that's the
way you cut that off.
Anyway,
you love it, and then at the end you go. Anyway. Maybe that's enough.
This is my number four pick. It's Mary J. Blige's debut album. It came out in July of '92. This album. So here's some accolades. This album led to her being named the Queen of Hip Hop Soul. She became the most successful new female R&B artist of 1992. In 2022, it had sold 3.5 million copies. It peaked at number six on the U.S. Billboard 200, reached number one on the top R&B hip-hop albums chart, certified triple platinum. The album was voted the year's 30 best in the Village Voices End of Year poll. It also earned Blige two Soul Train Music Awards for Best New R&B Artist, Best R&B Album for a Female. It has since been viewed by critics as one of the 1990s most important records, hence why I picked it. In 2020, the album was ranked number 271 on Rolling Stone's 500 Greatest Albums of All Time. Let's see, the title, What's the 411? I didn't know this. What's the 411 came from Blige's past occupation as a 411 operator. It was also an indication of Blige of being the real deal.
The real deal. Yeah.
It's been described as revelatory on a frequent basis, the decade's most explosive coming out displays of pure singing prowess, groundbreaking in its fusion of R&B hooks and hip-hop beats, creating the formula for the contemporary R&B of the following decade. I like that quote because I think it's true. If you listen to a lot of 90s hip-hop, sounds a lot like this album, and I think this is the album that started it. A powerful, soulful voice and hip-hop attitude. The album succeeded because Blige's fly girl attitude.
Are you saying Mary J. Blige is responsible for the R&B of the 90s?
I don't know.
All right.
You Remind Me was called one of those perfect singer-to-song matches. Her powerful voice was compared to Chaka Khan.
Ooh.
Anita Baker.
Chaka Khan.
One of the most accomplished fusions of soul values and hip-hop to date.
Yeah.
She was noted for having a tough girl persona and streetwise lyrics.
Yes.
Yeah. So anyway, I think this is a great album.
I know a couple of the songs because they hit the radio, but I didn't have this album. Not a huge Mary J. Blige person in 1992.
And this is another one that kind of it has some little interludes.
Yeah.
Where it gets song interlude.
All right.
So anyway,
we have exhausted our first four picks in those categories. So now I am free to do whatever I want.
And now it's going to get really weird.
Now it's going to get strange. Although this one's not strange at all, I'm going to go back into the rock category.
Okay.
And you're going to find in my next six picks, I've got several rock choices because in 1982, that's what I did. So that's what I loved. For me, killing it, you had a Rage Against the Machine's album. I would say timeless, great album. But my third favorite album that year, I already got Core, which I said was my first favorite album. This was my second favorite album that year. It was from Alice in Chains.
Oh.
A little bit of Dirt.
Dirt. Yep. That belongs there. You're good. Woo.
Man, my starting five is a little ruthless at this point. So, got STP, got Dr. Dre, got Gin Blossoms,
I like it.
Boomerang, and now I get STP and Dirt.
That's okay.
Yeah, I know you say it's okay.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, listen to that.
Yeah, it's good. Fantastic. One of the songs of the 90s, maybe? It's up there.
Oh. And we joke.
We joke.
We joke sometimes. We talk about voices of a generation and blah, blah, blah.
Elaine's Day is really
good. One. And there's one. No joke.
No joke.
Voice of a
generation. So that is Rooster, for anyone who's not familiar with Dirt, Alice in Chains. This is their second full studio album since it was released September 29th, 1992, is the band's most popular record. It spawned five huge singles, including Rooster, Down in a Hole, Dem Bones, really good song, Angry Chair, really good. Every song's good. And of course, Wood, my favorite song on the album. It's also included on the singles movie soundtrack, which Rob just mentioned. Dirt was nominated for a Grammy, losing disgustingly, I use that word disgustingly, to Van Hagar. And it was nominated for an MTV Video Music Award for Best Video from a Film for Wood, losing to Bohemian Rhapsody from Wayne's World, which I can accept that one. That's a pretty timeless video also. It peaked at number 6 on the U.S. Billboard 200, is certified 5 times platinum in the U.S. It's ranked as 26th on Rolling Stone's Top 100 Greatest Metal Albums of All Time. It's included in the book of 1,001 Albums You Must Listen to Before You Die. Rolling Stone ranked it number 6 on its list of 50 Greatest Grunge Albums. So lots of accolades. People love the album. We could spend an entire episode on this album. And who knows, maybe we will someday. But it is considered a quintessential album of grunge and of the 90s. Although it's not a happy album, it's about drugs, suicide, death, etc. It's still one of the best things you'll listen to from the 90s. Great rock songs, memorable singles, no wasted tracks. And in my opinion, one of the best albums you could listen to in the 90s.
I kind of wish I would have gotten that one.
There we go. I like it. I like sticking a thorn in your craw.
Well, that's not nice.
I like it. I'm not here to be nice. I'm here to assemble the best musical team I can come up with.
I have to be honest. I didn't like how you said that.
Well,
I like that. That's fine. Like it.
I like it a lot.
I like it. Well, so what are we at? We're at
You're at number 5.
My number 5.
Yes.
Okay, so here's where it's going to get a little weird, and I don't care.
We all are aware that you don't care.
Suck it, Trebek. Okay, here we go. I'm having some technical difficulties over here. My internet has decided to
quit. Mine's on. So that's good, right? We can work together on this. You tell me what you want me to play. I'll play it for you. We can just, while you work on that situation, I will entertain the masses, if you will. So we could just do a quick recap of what we've heard so far. So for my first 5 picks, for anyone who just joined the podcast, which this would be a weird spot to jump in, but I don't know. I don't know what people listen to. I took Core from Stone Temple Pilots at number 1. I took Nothing But a G. Well, I didn't. I took Core. I took The Chronic from Dr. Dre. I played Nothing But a G Thing from our number 2. I took Gin Blossoms with New Miserable Experience. That was my 3rd pick. I then took the Boomerang soundtrack in my movie soundtrack category. For my 4th pick, and then for my 5th pick, I just played Dirt by Alice in Chains, which, of course, we have just re-emphasized multiple times how great that album is. And on the other side of the coin, Rob went with Rage Against the Machine, self-titled album from 1992, their debut album. His 2nd pick, a fantastic rap album, Beastie Boys, Check Your Head, played What You Want. Number 3, you went with a movie soundtrack, the single soundtrack. Everybody loved the single soundtrack from the 90s. For his number 4 pick, he went with Mary J. Blige because he just cannot resist Mary J. Blige. There's 2 ladies in the 90s he can't resist. Well, we'll say 3. Oh. Mary J. Blige.
Yeah.
Lauryn Hill and Erykah Badu. Yeah, so I do those like are his Erykah big. Badu. That's the big 3
yeah,
for
if she
Rob.
Would have had something in 92, I would have
that's
picked
it. The big 3 for Rob in the 90s. So far that's gotten our 9 picks, and now we're to your number 5 pick.
Okay.
And now we're on deck and we're ready to roll?
We're going to take a little break.
Take a little
and
break.
And we're going to come back after these studio announcements.
After these messages. And we're back. The boys are running out of the booth. Kip had the day off, but we called him in on his day off to assist Rob. He ran right over here in the snow, even though Rob said he doesn't like it. We've got the computer fixed. We've got the music fixed. So we gave him the recap, Rob. It's time for your number 5 song. We've been dangling that for too long now, so let's give it to him.
Yeah. Okay, so my number 5 is... You're not going to like it.
That's right. R&B, right?
Yeah.
Is this...
You'll get it.
It makes sense in my head, but I can't pin it down.
This is Brian McKnight.
Brian McKnight. I should have known that.
So good.
I was waiting for Brian McKnight. It was either Brian McKnight or Brian Adams. I just couldn't remember which one.
Not Brian Adams. No Brian Adams on this list.
He didn't Dude, this wasn't his long-awaited R&B album?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
He does everything else according to you, so you might as well throw in an R&B album.
All right.
That's not terrible. You're over there like, oh, you're going to hate this
one. Yeah, I like it. I love the whole album. So this is his this is Brian McKnight's debut album. It's called Brian McKnight. It's his, let's see, it features his then highest charting single, One Last Cry, when it reached number 13 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, and it's certified platinum. Some things about this album that people have said: McKnight is the most comforting R&B singer-songwriter to emerge since Keith Washington.
Ooh.
I don't know who that is. I didn't do my research.
Sure you do.
I didn't.
You didn't go spend some time on the YouTube and get you some Keith Washington?
I didn't.
Come on, Rob.
It's a mix.
You said before this started, probably your best prep that you've done for a show, and then you just omit Keith Washington?
Yeah, I didn't listen to
Keith. Thanks a lot.
A mix of, do you know who he is?
Keith Washington?
Yeah.
Of course I know.
I know. Okay. Figured it out. A mix of quiet storm and jazz-tinged R&B light with a few up-tempo numbers thrown in. I love that.
I like it.
Brian McKnight, with his brand of songwriting, a songwriter-driven piano man, Quiet Storm was unique among 1990s male solo singers. That's what I liked about this, because when it came out, a lot of the R&B stuff was, more Boys to Men-ish.
Okay.
And, you know, it was, and his was more, it kind of had some jazz to it, and I like that. Less commercial and more jazz-leaning than his later disc, a great album for a rainy winter afternoon.
Oh. That
comes up to be a theme in my picks today. McKnight's soft, bluesy voice.
Is that due to our Portland upbringing, a rainy afternoon?
I don't know. McKnight's soft, bluesy voice carries you away with the sounds of him playing the piano throughout every song. McKnight encompasses soul, rhythm, and blues, gospel, and jazz through his music, so you never get bored listening to the CD. There you go. McKnight ranks with legends in the music industry like Nat King Cole. Stevie Wonder, first for his great soothing voice and piano playing, and second because he is like no one else. If you hear any song McKnight sings on the album or any other, you know it's distinctly him. If you're looking for the best of early 90s R&B proto neo soul, make this an early stop. His album should go down in history as one of the greatest debut albums and greatest albums of all time.
Wow.
I saved that one almost for last.
Yeah, you did.
This album is a landmark in 1990s R&B. It is an album that will never get old because even artists now can't replicate Brian McKnight's musicianship and style.
Nice.
So I like this album.
You know who's as good as Brian McKnight from the early 90s?
I don't know. What you're going to say.
You don't know what I'm
going to
say?
I'm going to go with Keith Sweat.
Not Keith Sweat. He's more mid-90s.
Okay.
I'm going to go Johnny Gill right here. I love Johnny Gill.
All right. Okay.
Rub you the right way.
Yeah, I don't like that comparison.
I
think Brian McKnight holds a more prominent place.
Well, that's up to you. You have differing opinions at times. So.
All right.
All right. This takes me to my number 6 pick on the team. First player off the bench. Going back to the rap category, I'm going with the one and only Ice Cube. Album is called The Predator.
Are y'all playing basketball? Get me on the court and I'm troubled. Last week fucked around and got a triple double.
There is some language in
this. Wow.
But that's okay.
Like MJ, I can't believe today was a good day.
Ooh. I love that remix. Perfect.
I like how you mentioned the AK.
Drove to the pad and hit the showers. Didn't even get no static from the cowards.
This was,
that's
pretty good.
Love it. All right. I still say he couldn't get a triple-double and pick up ball. We played a lot of pick up ball, and games are normally to 12. You're not getting all the assists, all the points, all the rebounds. But that's fine. I'll let you live in that space, Ice Cube. The album's still banging, so I'm going to let it go. It was released November 17th, 1992, was produced by Ice Cube and DJ Pooh. I don't know who that is, but I just want to say DJ Pooh. So I imagine like a baseball cap, just a t-shirt and nothing else, right, in the studio?
Yeah.
All right.
You know what they call that? I learned this.
Oh.
When you walk around with just a t-shirt on?
Winnie the Pooh?
No, they call it shirt cocking.
Shirt. Ooh.
I know.
That's aggressive.
I know.
All right.
Yeah. There you go.
You're going to have to apologize to the
wife. Everybody just learned something.
You're going to have to apologize to the wife for that one.
I know, and I was going to be better this year. I'm sorry.
Well, great name for an album too, by the way, The Predator. It spawned two awesome singles that are vivid memories from my childhood. It Was a Good Day and Check Your Head featuring Das FX. The album debuted at number 1 on the Billboard 200 selling chart and was the 24th best-selling album for all of 1993. Album has been certified double platinum has sold 193,000 copies in its first week. That's amazing, wow. By the way.
Yeah.
The album's theme is based on the riots in L.A. in 1992 and addressing police brutality towards minorities in L.A., which is a hot topic for Ice Cube back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Fun fact on the track, Now I Gotta Whatcha, Ice Cube raps, "It's on like Donkey Kong," which has become a popular saying in pop culture, and that's the first time it was coined.
Was it?
In fact, in 2010, Nintendo trademarked the phrase to promote the Wii Donkey Kong game, and in the Super Mario Brothers movie from 2023, Donkey Kong uses the phrase in the movie himself.
Did Ice Cube get any?
I couldn't find where any royalties. I think
I'm shocked that he wouldn't have fought that.
But I think they just trademarked it, and he hadn't already. But he owns the song, so I'm not sure how. But there was no info on any court battle or anything like that. So, but it's on like Donkey Kong.
Yeah, he should have fought that, man.
Fought.
All right. Well, here's where I'm gonna just tell everybody out there. Let the hate mail come.
You know, the idea is we're trying to draft. Albums
I am. I'm drafting albums
that are really good.
I am.
But also that our fans at home would like to listen to.
I think there are people out there that will enjoy this, and I'm going to pick it. So here we go.
There you go.
This is about my number six.
Number six.
You're going to hate it. You're going to hate it.
I don't love it.
I know.
I don't even know what it is.
So this is a band called The Sundays. I know you're rolling your eyes.
Okay, Rob. No, this is The Sundays.
But they're good.
And you weren't listening to them when you were 14.
Okay, no, but I have a disclaimer.
No.
All right. So that's The Sundays.
It's very sleepy.
It is.
Okay.
Yes, it is.
Just in case you're wondering.
So this is the second studio album from The Sundays.
Yes.
They only released three. This was released in October of 92 in the UK and a little, like the next day, it was like simultaneously UK and US. It is often considered the darkest and most experimental of the Sundays albums, noted for its melancholic lyrics. The title of the album is from a lyric in the song 24 Hours. So there's another song on there called 24 Hours and they use the phrase blind.
Nice.
The title, the album is called Blind, by the way. We talked earlier about the imagery of an album. So this album is kind of known for its cover art. It's got a toy doll, like a creepy looking doll on the front.
You're not selling me on the Sundays.
Yeah. The album peaked at number 15 on the UK albums chart. Rock and Roll magazine, The Trouser Press, awful name for a magazine.
Reputable.
Wrote that, quote, "While increased confidence and ambition make Wheeler's, Harriet Wheeler is the singer." And in the kind of mid to late 90s, I had a crush on Harriet Wheeler's voice. If there is such a thing.
All right.
"Make Harriet Wheeler's singing more technically accomplished. Her development from adolescent wonder to adult deducts some of the band's gravity defying magic," is what he says.
Oh, nice.
So I listened to a new podcast.
Oh.
Yeah. It's called the Dig Me Out podcast.
You told me about it.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah.
They on one of their episodes, they talk about this whole album. The episode's all about this album. They had a great conversation about reading the lyrics of an album. Mm-hmm. And one of the people on there called themselves a lyric junkie. And they said, "And letting the music just play and wash over you."
All right.
So I thought that was really cool. So he talked about him playing it in the car. He goes, "I don't remember a lot of the lyrics. I just remember this album playing in the background, like driving to college or something."
Oh.
So me personally, I will admit, I did not know this album in 92.
Okay.
Because I was 14.
I'll give you that.
In 97, though.
Okay.
I found their album Static and Silence.
Mm-hmm.
Loved it.
Okay.
Then I went back and got their catalog, and I loved it. They've been compared to the Smith, the Cocktail Twins, 10,000 Maniacs, Mazzy Starts, get kind of that voice, right?
Yeah.
I talked about Harriet Wheeler's voice, and you said it earlier. I said, it feels like a rainy Saturday in Portland.
There you go. You like sitting around rainy Saturdays in Portland.
I've said that since the beginning.
That's fine.
I'm going to take some crap for that.
Yeah, I know a lot of music, and I, until this moment, had never heard of The Sundays, had never heard that song.
Yeah.
And I'm just thinking to myself, why didn't your internet dump on that song? No, I'm just kidding. It's not that bad. You've played much worse.
It dumped on, I might shock you on what I'm going to play today. I might drop a few.
That's great. Well, then there's no chance we're stealing any of each other's picks. So
no, from here on out.
From here on out, no, because you're all weird. Okay, yep. So my number seven choice for the team comes from my favorite band of all time, Nirvana, and it is off the Incesticide album. Love this. So good. How could you not listen to that and just not be happy? All right.
That sounds like a rainy day in Seattle.
There you go. Well, that is Stain off of the Incesticide album. What a fantastic song. Drastically different album after Nevermind, because this was released after Nevermind. Didn't have near the commercial success, and it's actually just a collection of mostly unreleased songs recorded during different sessions. So the songs feature four different drummers on the album because they were recorded over like 4 years. It was released December 14th, 1992, only because Kurt Cobain had complete control over the cover artwork. He was originally not going to release any of these songs, and then they said he could design the cover art, and he said, okay, we can release the songs. So they drove a hard bargain. Look, I'm not questioning Kurt's artistic ability, but if you look at the cover art, it kind of looks like Kurt Cobain drew it. So it's a little stick artish, you know, and things like that. So album peaked at number 39 in the US Billboard Hot 100 and was certified 2x platinum in Canada and platinum in the US and the UK, platinum in both places. No singles were actually released from the album, but alternate versions of Been a Son, Polly, and Aneurysm, which was originally a B-side for Smells Like Teen Spirit, were included on the album. Upon its release, the record company did not want to overly market it so as not to incite the Nirvana burnout after Nevermind. However, it sold really well despite being a bunch of B-sides and really having no marketing whatsoever. It's kind of like a demo record even. It's not anyone's first album they think of for Nirvana, but I love the raw and little less produced garage sound that it has. Fun to listen to. Great songs like Stain, Aneurysm, which might be one of my top five favorite Nirvana songs of all time. In fact, we're doing a Nirvana episode in a few weeks, and I could see some more songs from Incesticide popping up.
Oh, for sure.
Yes.
For sure.
So,
No, that's really good. I'm in the middle of reading Everybody Loves Our Town.
Oh, yes.
And then,
I have to start that book.
Yeah.
For everyone out there, because he's such a good friend of mine, Rob gave me the book for Christmas, so I have had it for a month plus now,
yeah.
And I have not started yet because I'm still reading 60 songs.
Which I have to start reading because that was a gift you gave to me. Yeah,
nice. We're so smart we gave each other books. That's right. That's how intelligent we are.
Okay, so my number seven.
Yes. Do you want me to just take a nap?
Just what?
You want me to just go to sleep?
No, this is a little more upbeat. Okay. Here we go.
There we go. Sounds like a Black Crowes.
It is.
Oh, okay.
Good job. Yeah.
Definitely sounds like them. Oh.
Yes. So this is the Black Crowes.
Black Crowes.
This is their second studio album. I will also say this is one that I was not listening to in 92.
Found it later.
A couple years later.
Gotcha.
So the Hard to Handle was kind of the one that we kind of grew up on knowing the Black Crowes.
Yep.
And then this album came out. But yeah, this is their second studio album, released in May of 92. The album's name derives from the full name of the Southern Harmony, an influential 1835 hymnal. It was a record for an album to feature four album rock number one hits, previously set by Tom Petty in 1989. He had three. They had four. It was number one on the Billboard 200 album chart. In 2005, it ranked number 477 in Rock Hard magazine's book, The 500 Greatest Rock and Metal Albums of All Time. And in 2006, ranked number 100 on Guitar World's magazine list of the greatest 100 guitar albums of all time.
It did very well.
Yeah.
Yes.
Here's the quote that I like.
Oh.
And I apologize. I give no credit to the quotes. I don't know who said them. I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah. I failed that part of ELA or language arts, you know, citing your sources. I don't have that. There's not much better than piping up the Southern Harmony and Musical Companion on a Sunday afternoon, which is the title of this album.
Nice.
Or during a long drive and losing yourself in the waves of American music goodness that you really have to go back to the 60s and 70s to find comparable experiences from the Southern rock sphere. The Southern Harmony and Musical Companion was classic and has proven itself to be timeless.
Timeless.
And I like it. I love every song on this, front to back, is great. The name of that song that I played is called Sometimes Salvation.
What category do you think that falls in?
I'll
go rock on that.
Yeah, I'll go rock on that one.
You know what's interesting about that song? Not that you're going to care at all, but it's weird that you play that song because yesterday I was watching TV at home. Hulu Live, I have a 90s videos channel, and he was playing this song live. And he was holding an umbrella on stage. So I'm not sure why, because it was an indoor venue.
Yeah.
But everyone else was in all black. He was wearing like an all white suit.
Yeah.
But it was that song.
No way.
I was watching the video while I was sitting at home because I was just watching videos. And that's weird that you played that song. So.
Oh, that is weird.
I thought so.
Yeah. I wanted to give a shout out to the Smoking Sounds podcast.
Oh, nice.
Our guys, our friends over there. This sounds like something I could hear them listening to while they're enjoying one of their
cigars.
Favorite cigars.
And whiskey or scotch, whatever they drink.
This would be playing in the background. So maybe on an episode, they'll play a little Black Crowes.
I think they could also play Staying in the Background from Nirvana, but that's okay.
They could
play that too.
I think this would be a great playlist for any of them.
No, for any of them. So, all right. Well, I'm going to go to my number eight pick. I'm going to stay in the rock category because I just want to take this album here. Mm-hmm. I'm doing something I don't normally do on countdowns like this. I'm repeating an artist.
Wow.
Because they actually put two albums out in 1992. So I'm going back to Alice in Chains.
Oh.
It is the Sap album.
Oh.
And the song is called Got Me Wrong. I love this. So I couldn't, if it was available. And I felt like you might take this because of its kind of uniqueness.
Yeah.
It's different than their other albums.
Yeah, Jar of Flies for me was the one.
Jar of Flies is amazing. Just didn't come out in 92.
Yeah, that's the one that I was like, this is different. We were talking about that book, Everybody Loves Our Town.
Yeah.
There's a great part in there where they're talking about just to be a fly on the wall. Alice in Chains is partying with the guys from Poison.
Oh, my God. That sounds crazy. First of all.
Right?
That sounds crazy.
But the way they're describing it, they're hanging out and they're talking about music.
Yeah.
But the guys from Poison are talking about how kind of like their time is ending.
Oh, okay.
And
well, at least they knew.
And Alice in Chains' time's beginning, coming but they're up. All hanging together. And I just
why not?
What an odd room to be in where you've got Brett Michaels and Poison and you got Lane Staley and they're hanging out and they're talking music.
But to be fair, CC DeVille will go anywhere drugs are available. So, and I'm sure Alice in Chains had plenty of drugs for them. So, so again, this has Got Me Wrong off of the Sap album by Alice in Chains. Shortest album on my list. It only has five tracks, but it's great to listen to. Released February 4th, 1992. So it actually came out before Dirt. It's the second studio album from the band. The album is mostly acoustic, and it is the first time Jerry Cantrell sings lead vocals on the song. The song is Brother, and he splits lead with Lane Staley on Got Me Wrong. So it's the first time he sang on the tracks as well. The album features guest vocals from Ann Wilson of Heart, Mark Arm of Mudhoney, and Chris Cornell of Soundgarden. And the album is certified gold in the U.S. It was released with no marketing because the band wanted to see if people would buy it by just finding it.
Oh.
It was re-released in 1995 to much success after Got Me Wrong was featured in the 1994 movie Clerks. I remember a little Kevin Smith black and white movie.
Yeah.
I'm not even supposed to be here today. It's a whole thing, right? just a great album to listen to. Maybe one of your rainy day albums.
Yeah.
The music is rich, and although it doesn't necessarily make you feel good, I still enjoy listening to it every time I hear it. So, and that's one of the best songs. Got Me Wrong.
That is good. So. I guess I didn't realize. I know that song.
Yeah.
I guess I didn't realize it was off the Sap album. I should know that, and I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's bad.
I'm admitting that. I don't. I don't like to admit that.
That's bad.
Yeah. All right. So,
Oh, where are you going to go?
Well.
Number eight. I mean, if you want to pick an album people have heard, it's okay.
No, I don't want to. This really is going to hit that. It's going to really hit that mark.
Hooray.
Yeah, you're going to love it.
We've turned into one of those podcasts where like, oh, he's so hip and cool. No. Just pick crisscross. Everybody likes that.
I don't want to. Oh, this. This is going to go into my rap category. It'd be rap, obviously. Okay. Yeah. And you want to ask what Grand Pooba gave you? Some dope shit. Some real life shit. I love this. That's really good.
Okay.
It'd be good. Like, anyway.
That's good.
Playing in the background.
Oh, I like it. That's good.
Yeah. Anyway. Okay. So this is an album called Heavy Rhyme Experience Volume 1.
Okay.
Okay. It's by the brand new Heavies.
Yes,
we've talked about them several times.
We have not talked about.
I have.
You have talked.
They were
about
on
them.
They were on the 97 R&B.
Yes. To which we got a comment. They're like, "Brand new Heavies?" Question mark.
Yes.
So there
right?
you go. Yeah.
Well, now people will know. So anyway, okay. Here's another one. Okay, 92. Not listening. I get it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Right. Let me have it. Whatever. 94 though, they had an album come out called Brother Sister.
Yes.
Then they had an album come out in 97. Called Shelter. Loved both of them. In 94, when I got Brother Sister, liked them so much, I went back and I got their previous stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
The thing I like about this, this is kind of, it was a little bit ahead of its time. So it came out in obviously 92, but what it was is it was the brand new Heavies, it was their band, and then they got together with a bunch of rap artists and they got together and did like a collaboration album, which nice. I thought was really cool. So it's, people have said it's a must have for any hip hop fans record collection. The sophomore album from British acid jazz band, the brand new Heavies. People have said it's long ahead of its time. One of those albums that you can vibe to real easily with only 10 tracks. Yeah. So it has 10 tracks and it's only 35 minutes long. This album may feel a little short sounding, but it does quickly get to the point. Fans of live music or live sounding music will like this one. It does have a little crossover appeal to it, but it still keeps its place in the acid, jazz, and hip hop areas. Rather than relying on processed beats and looped samples, the Heavies provide the MCs with genuine instrumental tracks with enough funk to get all but the comatose up and out of their chairs. So it reminds me a little bit of the same thing the Beastie Boys did on Check Your Head. There's some live music.
Okay. Right? I don't think they're not in the same category. That's okay.
That's okay. This album should be on every top 100 hip hop albums of all time list. It lacks of widespread critical recognition, much less commercial success, is practically a crime. This is what people are saying about it. One of the early reviewers was right to say that it might not totally grab you in the first listen, but if you give it a few more listens, it opens up and proves to have serious legs. And I think that goes back to kind of my criteria at the beginning where I said, does it have replayability? Yep. Can it, you know, and does it hit? I think it hits all those things. So
all
anyway.
Mine have all that stuff.
No, I do too. I think every pick you've done has been fantastic.
Well, we're about to end that cycle real quick.
Oh boy.
So my first 8 picks are all great. It's great. But my last 2 picks here, since I have no fear, I can just pick whatever I prepared here. I'm going to have a little fun with the last 2 picks. And they're
as
definitely not going to be anything Rob's interested in. So all 8 picks have been fantastic. They're about to go down the toilet because I'm going to play this real quick. I'm going to play the song, then I'll tell you what the album is.
What the heck is this?
I don't know. It's live, though. I can't believe you don't know what this is at this point.
Roxette? Live?
Live.
I didn't even know they did such a thing.
They did. Why wouldn't they? They're great. Like, okay. Listen to this.
All right.
So this is the album Tourism by Roxette. This is it's a live album. So, and that was Joyride live in Sydney, Australia. So for our friends down under, I cannot resist some Roxette. Obviously this was released August of 1992. It's often mistaken for a live album. That's why I said it to you, but the band said it's a touring album. They recorded their favorite versions of their songs from the Joyride tour, as they were out, and they took their favorite versions of all those places and they put it on one big album, and it's great. The album contains songs from 3 live concert recordings. Another song was recorded in an empty nightclub in Sao Paulo, Brazil, and 2 other songs at a hotel in Buenos Aires. It only hit number 117
listen to you on the nailing Billboard. All those foreign places. Good for you.
It only hit number 117 on the Billboard 200, criminally low, but number one in Belgium, Denmark, Finland, Germany, Norway, Switzerland, and what's the last country?
That you're going to go with? You already said Australia.
We'll go with their home country, Sweden.
Canada.
A little slow on the uptake there. So some songs that charted higher than this were Ugly Kid Joe. A Helmet album went higher than this, an Enya album, and of course, The Heights soundtrack featuring our very own Jamie Walters. These all ranked higher than this album.
I saw The Heights come up upsetting. Over and over again as I was 92 releases. So, this came out. I'm shocked it didn't make it.
We've done enough with The Heights. Okay. Right? The LA Times praised Fredrickson's vocals as one of pop's best and most underrated singers, and I couldn't agree more. But he also said the material on the album was beneath her talents. So it's kind of like a backhanded compliment, apparently. Yeah. I disagree with the second part. It's weird because it's their previously recorded songs, just live. So I guess he thinks all their songs are beneath her at this point. And Dennis Hunt, since I know you're listening, you're wrong. And maybe they should take your credentials away. I don't know how old you are now. I don't know if you write anymore, but you made a big mistake in this case. So, but yeah, rock set tourism. Live touring songs. It's a lot of fun.
Is there a difference between a touring album and a live album?
So
they obviously make
it. They think it's different. Well, I guess a live album is it's in one spot. You record the whole thing. This is from a variety of concerts, their favorite versions at each venue.
Okay, fine.
So
to each his own.
To each their own.
Tomato, potato, whatever. Yep.
All right, that's my ninth pick. So. All right,
and my last two picks are going to be not, what did you say? You're playing, you're going to have fun.
Have fun. Right.
Anyway, my number, I'm going to go with my number nine.
Ooh.
Is, you're going to hate this one too.
I like that you know it ahead of time, but you do it anyway.
Here I am with this old guitar.
Hear me out, man. Doing you don't have to like it. It's my list.
We're not Neil Young people. This is not a Neil Young show.
Okay, I have a quote. No.
Is this at least Jimmy Fallon making fun of
him? No, okay. It really is. It really is him.
And you really just want to do that, don't
no,
you?
No. And then I like this album. I did. I.
All right.
And I'll tell you why.
He sucks. That's what I tell you.
It's great songwriting. It's good songwriting. It really is.
You just can't listen to him sing.
I know.
I just don't know why.
He's not everybody's. I know.
I just don't.
I know.
He always looks half asleep when he's singing. You know, he's just like, he looks like he hasn't showered in 3 weeks. So, that's
all
on you.
All of those are true.
I cannot go all of those down are the true. Neil Young all right. road all with you.
Anyway, this is an album called Harvest Moon. So the one that he's most kind of known for is an album called Harvest, and that came out in 72. And I remember my dad having this album.
Okay.
And he'd play it on the turntable on our record player. So when this came out in 92, I
had to have it.
Because I was like, well, my dad liked them. So
all right.
And it grew on me.
I'll retract a little of my, since it's a father-son bonding
but
thing.
But I do like it, though.
All right.
I'm not going to take that back. Okay. So it's his 19th studio album. He's kind of known, well, he has a title of being called the Godfather of Grunge.
Okay.
There you go. Many of his backing musicians also appeared on, so the same people that helped him do Harvest in 72 came back and helped him do this in 92. This album's called Harvest Moon. Yeah, they did there. Harvest Moon.
I see that.
Much speculation has been made about the relationship of this album to Young's 72 album. However, he said, no, it's not. There's no connection there. Music website Classic Rock Review named Harvest Moon its album of the year in 92. It earned the 1994 Juno Award for album of the year. Canadians liked it.
Canadians like lots of things I don't agree with them with. They like Bryan Adams.
Okay. This next accolade totally falls into what you said.
Okay.
The song Harvest Moon topped the AARP's list of 16 songs everyone over 50 should own.
Oh, that's great. And you were listening to it when you were 14.
Oh, that's awesome. Man.
Yes.
Described as positively gorgeous.
Okay.
I just think the songwriting is really good. It's a beautiful album that proudly displays scars, heartaches, and love. Love it. The music is slow and easy. Young on an acoustic guitar that works on tracks like the title song and You and Me. But for the most part, this is Paint by Numbers Neil.
That's great. So that,
you know. Yeah. Wonderful melodies, vocals, and songwriting. A melancholic, sweet, and intimate record, well delivered and well written. A back to basics folk album. Neil Young and his guitar paint a wonderful masterpiece of mellow and graceful beauty. I love those all.
Yeah.
Anyway, so
you know, you say it's great.
I do like it.
Writing. Yeah. Bob Dylan and Neil Young are the same to me. Where it's like they just sat down and like looked around the room. And it's like videotape sitting on a shelf by the license plates of the poster and the lamp. And they're like, "It's gold album."
I'm not denying that. That's true.
That's true. He says, right?
But I like it.
I'm not saying you don't like it.
I like it.
You know what I really appreciate about this is people are going to listen to this and they're like, "Yeah, you did." David picked everything off the radio. Rob's over here like, oh, this was, you know, this deep album with like this and that and the other. And it's one of the 400 best jazz albums for people over 90 and, you know, blah, blah, blah. So, and then everybody, and I look so simple next to this. So I appreciate my simpleton looking.
That's not true. No.
So everyone out there knows my taste doesn't venture outside the Billboard 200.
You watch. Our YouTube people will go, that's dumb.
That's and no.
Everybody will love SAP.
All the smart. We're gonna attract the smart crowd now. The smart like.
Yeah, I don't know that our podcast.
We're gonna attract that. We're gonna attract that smart B side crowd.
Oh yeah.
Those are those kids in college nobody wanted to talk to because they're like, no, you shouldn't listen to that song. You should listen to this song. And then you're like, I don't like that song.
So the pretentious crowd.
Yeah, that's you. Since our first episode.
Hey, I will point out on your little poster right there.
Yeah.
Bottom row.
The
second from the right next to Pablo Honey.
Is it the Neil Young album?
Bam.
Boom. All right.
Yep. There it is.
All right. Well, my number 10 pick, just to be as basic as possible, because we've gone down that road. This is not the 10th best album I would have ever had. Not the 10th best album in 1992. But in 1992, because I'm going to actually reflect myself to that time, I had this album. I listened to it a lot. I thought it was awesome. I look back on it now. It's not as good, and it sounds a little dated. But it has good nostalgia. I still enjoy some of the songs. It is Warm It Up off of the Totally Crossed Out album by Chris Cross. I'm about
to warm it up. Oh, I like it. I had this single.
Yes.
Cassette single.
A casingo. Sounds right.
I like it.
I think I heard that somewhere. I don't want to take credit for that. Some good writing here, right?
Oh, yeah.
Pretty basic. It doesn't not sound like Jump, but that's okay. So you can clown on it if you want to.
No.
This album was everywhere in 1992. Released in March. After the success of the single Jump, it shot to number one on the U.S. Billboard 200 sales chart and the U.S. top R&B hip-hop albums chart. It was number two in Canada, number seven in Australia. It's been certified 7 times platinum worldwide sales. Besides Jump, other popular singles were I Missed the Bus. I know you like that one. And, of course, what I just played, Warm It Up. I always thought Warm It Up, as I just said, sounds a little like Jump. A little similar sound, and their flow's kind of the same, but if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Hey, work the first time, run it right back. That's okay. You know, Limp Bizkit made a great living doing that. So,
oh, yeah.
This album and Jump in general kind of define early 90s rap, at least in radio circles. I would say until The Chronic dropped, this was kind of the rap I listened to. And then once The Chronic dropped, listened to other rap. So popularity crisscross spawned other acts for a short period of time, like Another Bad Creation, who were awesome. And of course, they'll forever be known as the guys who wore their clothes backwards for no apparent reason. And that really didn't catch on, but they had high hopes.
Yeah, it didn't catch on.
For the clothes going backwards. So I fully admit it's not the 10th best song.
Oh, no.
Or album.
I understand.
But I like it.
You
has
like
good
it.
Nostalgia, so it's at the bottom. And I took it 10th.
I think it's
and
okay.
I felt safe setting my draft room up that this would never come off the board to you, so I could always take it at 10. So, all right. Now that I've done that,
yes.
I'm sure you're going to come kicking in the door with some band like Radiohead or, you know, somebody smart like that.
No.
Or a band no one's heard of course.
It's a gentleman that.
It's a gentleman. A gentleman caller.
Yeah.
Know what it is?
No.
I look at the walls and I sing some songs.
Want to be mine alone.
You're going to not
that's
like
a
it.
Choice.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
This is John Lee Hooker.
You know, I was drafting albums as a teenager, and you're drafting albums as a 53-year-old, like, a guy who owns a bar woman. Or something. So that's fine. Yeah, it all works.
That's all works.
You know what this song reminds me of? It reminds me of the bar scene in
Roadhouse.
Weird Science when they're drunk and he's like, "Oh, yeah. She kicked me in the nuts, man."
Well. Yeah. No, I admit
that. Give me the key, that drag.
Yeah, I fully admit that I was not listening to John Lee Hooker in 1992. Yes.
I remember coming into your room and you're just sitting in the corner. Oh, Dave, listen to this. Get out of here. Come on. It's ridiculous. No one was
that would have been funny.
Yeah. You jump in the car.
It's all smoky, it's all smoky in my room.
You. Yeah, I got a CD for you here. Right out the window. Put Crisscross back in.
Oh, that's funny. So, no, this I saw this. It came up, and I
just
this is my number
yourself.
10. This is my number 10.
This is this countdown today is your opportunity to throw all of these things on here because normally I restrict you with certain parameters and lists so I can ensure we don't run into these things.
I meant to say that at the beginning is that you didn't.
I know.
Put some parameters.
I thought the categories would keep you a little constrained, but you, like, what category is that going?
Oh, I don't care.
Oh, okay.
So whatever that's category
fine.
I want it
yeah,
to
that's
be.
Fine. Yeah, that's fine. Okay.
The Robsters Unite. John Lee, so this is John Lee Hooker. He was in his 70s when he wrote this. So I did not find John Lee Hooker until I was in, right after high school. Okay. So it was many years later. Super, just dig him. I think he's really good. And the fact that I said dig him.
Yeah. Sugar Smacks. There you go.
The album felt so. He had an album in '89 called The Healer, and then he had another one in, and it got a Grammy Award for Best Traditional Blues Recording. And then '91, he had an album come out that was nominated for a Grammy. But before, so in between those, he had one called this is called Boom Boom.
Boom Boom.
Yeah, and he's famous for a song called Boom Boom. But a lot of these songs. were released earlier in his career. He has some new ones in there, but most of them kind of, but they were designed as an introduction to his classic songs for a new audience. Mm. So there's a really good one called I'm Bad Like Jesse James. It's really good on his album, The Cafe A Go-Go, Live at the Cafe A Go-Go. I own that one. It's really good. Anyway, so the album features guys like Jimmy Vaughn, Robert Cray, Albert Collins, all blues guys. They say Hooker's guitar playing is a master class in the art of less is more. I love that. Boom Boom will never feature near the top of John Lee Hooker's album discography. It is, however, a fine album and well worth seeking out if you're a fan of his music. Okay, this is the last thing I want to say about him. In the liner notes for his 1966 album, It Serves You Right to Suffer, Stanley Dance, contributing editor of Jazz Magazine and Saturday Review, says this about John Lee Hooker, quote, "Nobody else has such a massive, resolute beat, nor his mesmeric ability to convey deeply felt emotion over somber, tolling guitar chords. Certainly, there are some lively good time blues here, but there are also some mighty sad ones."
Uh-huh.
In fact, you also run the risk when you put on an album by John Lee Hooker on the turntable, because he can make you suffer right along with him. Perhaps there's purpose in that too. I love that quote.
The suffer part I can agree with.
Yes.
That's great. I suffered along with the rest of you. So, hey, just for our fans out there and for myself, in the future, when we do this again, because we will, I will definitely have a little more instructions for Rob. Something like, you had to have listened to it in the year that it came out, not 40 years later when you got into your blues phase of life.
Fair.
That's fair.
That's fair.
But that's my fault. Fair. I did not give you, I thought you'd stay, but I should know now you will not color inside the lines at this point. it's beyond you. So
I didn't see it in the notes.
Those are our teams, our top 10 draft picks for albums of 1992. I think we have a great mixture of things. I'm very happy with my 10. I know Rob is very pleased with himself with his 10.
I am happy with my 10.
This will be a weird playlist for people at home. They'll be like, ooh, Alice in Chains. Ooh, Beastie Boys. Ooh, John Lee Hooker. Yeah, okay. So I guess we'll just do that, right? That's okay. Skip is available, folks. Don't worry about it. You can go right to the next one. Lots of good albums. Several I didn't get to draft because we only have 10 spots and there were lots of albums that year.
Do you know which ones? Do you have some that you would have picked off the top of your head?
If albums that were relevant to me at that time, because that's the way I attacked this, was I had Def Leppard's the Def Leppard album that had Let's Get Rocked. I believe the name of the album was, I don't have it in front of me at the moment, Adrenalize. I believe it's Adrenalize.
Okay.
I had also had a Celine Dion album. I had the MTV Unplugged for Mariah Carey.
Oh, God.
John Cicada.
John Cicada.
And then I had the AC/DC Live, which was actually quite a pivotal album for me.
I had it. I almost put it on.
Yeah, but it was way too popular, folks, so he couldn't put it on there. You can't have any songs we recognize, not today.
That was the first live album I think I ever listened to. Yeah, you had it. You owned it. I'd never heard a live album before.
Yeah. And then we saw him at the Laser Light Show at OMSI.
Oh, that's right.
A whole lot of rose. So, yep. You have any other crazy albums you left off?
No.
Anything there from the Mamas and the Papas? Hey, maybe there's something on there from Louis Armstrong. I don't know.
Garth Brooks, The Chase was a popular country.
Yeah, you could have gone country. You know, yeah. I wasn't listening to a ton of country.
Oh, and then a lot about Living Little About Love.
Yeah.
Little Alan Jackson year, 92. Those would have been two
good ones for you.
Yeah.
Yeah. That during your 92 country phase.
I did listen to them.
Okay. Well, that's good. All right. So, well, we think you still have a nice array of music at home, folks. And we recommend you listen to almost all of these albums all the way through. I'll let you decide on which ones those would be. So, well, if you'd like to contact Rob and I, which we always look forward to, you can find us on all the social media sites from Facebook to X, Instagram, YouTube. We provided links in the show notes, but you can also just Google Totally 80s and 90s Recall and anywhere on the interwebs and we will pop up. I promise. Go to the website. Have a good time.
I want to end with...
Well, it's not an end time. You had another part to read. Don't you? You don't have it today, huh?
I don't have it today.
Okay. Yeah. Well, Rob would have said, you can also find us at our website, totally80s90srecall at podbean.com. Now, I did the script, so maybe I left you out this time.
Yeah.
Finally, feel free to email us at 80s90srecall@gmail.com, where you can ask questions about current or previous episodes, suggest future show ideas, or simply just say hello. We look forward to hearing from all of our listeners. It is great when we hear from you. We like providing the fun and the good time. So, and that includes all you Robsters out there. Chime in. Let me know what you think of Rob's eclectic picks on today's show. So now, closing thoughts, Rob.
I wanted to leave us with a couple quotes.
Oh, great.
Yeah. So this is a Medium.com writer, Joja, writes, quote, experiencing an album is like a trip. And like a trip, set and setting has a lot to do with how you experience and perceive it. Thought that was good. Multi-genre singer, songwriter, record producer Hunter Hayes says, quote, a good album can make your day. A great album can change your life. Thought that was really good.
That is good.
And the last quote is by ZZ Top's frontman, Billy Gibbons. He says, well, everybody faces the fact that that there really aren't many record stores around to just go and browse. Maybe browse online. Yet the tactile feel of flipping through a stack of vinyl remains one of the life's simple pleasures. And I'm not saying just vinyl.
No, I know.
But the experience of...
I do.
The tactile experience of music. And I thought that was a really good quote.
I do miss... I used to wander around the store.
Yeah.
You'd go through and see if there was anything behind that you didn't know or
something like that.
So I do miss that.
Yeah.
You don't get to do that as much anymore. No. So. Well, we hope you've enjoyed our look at our favorite 1992 albums. A little draft process we had. If you like today's musical choices, we have provided links to Spotify, Apple, and Amazon playlists in the show notes. As I said, it'll be a nice eclectic playlist for you. It has just the songs we featured today, but we recommend listening to those entire albums. As with most of these, at least from the ones I know, there's not a lot of bad songs. They're fantastic from front to back. Finally, we'd like to thank all our listeners, whether first-timers or subscribers, for hanging out with Rob and I. Hopefully we gave you an hour or so of some laughs, some unique experiences with music, and don't forget to tune in for all new episodes of Totally 80s and 90s Recall. When, Rob?
Every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday.
All right.
Like clockwork.
Yeah.
We haven't missed a Tuesday yet.
No.
I hope not to ever miss a Tuesday.
We should be able to handle that.
I think so.
We might screw up our recording stuff. We might screw up the board. You might lose your internet, but we can get the thing on Tuesday.
And I may not follow the rules.
And that's been since day one. So that's fine. Let's not stop now. Let's keep it going, folks. So.
Okay. All right. What are we doing next time?
Next time we're doing our first of our 2 weeks of love for Valentine's Day, a little run up to Valentine's Day. We are going to put our list together of our favorite 80s power ballads.
Okay. All right.
So a little hair metal, a little glam rock, a little arena rock, however you want to look at it. Again, I didn't give you a lot on this, so hopefully, I'm sure we'll get something, folks. So that's fine. Just be ready. You know, think of the songs you would put on a power ballad and then come listen to the songs Rob would put on and you'll see the differences.
So. I'll play.
No,
I'll
you play don't have to play. Don't start that now. The Robsters expect better than that. So,
All right. Okay.
Well, you got anything else?
I got nothing else.
Fancy goodbye?
No fancy goodbye.
All right. John Lee Hooker.
Yeah.
14 years
old. Everybody saw that coming.
Ha 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 ha.